Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within. My anchor holds within. Dressed in His righteousness alone, fall and stand before the throne. Thank you.
presence. Have your way in this place. Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way. Have your way. Have your way. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. This is the day that you have made, and we are rejoicing in it. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. Thank you. Jesus, thank you for the cross. For your precious blood that you shed on the cross for us. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. All the glory and all the honor. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your presence. And our prayer once again in this place is not one of us to walk out the same way we came in. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, lift up your hand and say these words. Jesus, my heart is open to receive your holy word. Life-changing word. I give you permission to mess me up. Mess me up, Jesus, so I can mess up others for your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. Before you're seated in the presence of the Lord, find three people and say, thank God for your enemies. Woo! Thank God for your enemies. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Thank God for your enemies. I said, thank God for your enemies. Stop trying to pray out your enemies and start thanking God for your enemies. Yeah, family. I just have to say this just to stir us up a little bit for some of you that weren't here last night. Family has a tendency to humble us. Friends, true friends, you know, because some people say, I'm your friend, but really they're, yeah. Have you ever been around? Yeah. I'm talking about real friends. Encourage us. Family humbles us. Your enemies promote you. I said your enemies promote you. Amen. Now find one more person. Say, thank God for your enemies. Yeah. Amen. Amen. If I can have the ushers come forward at this time, we're going to take the offering. Amen. Tithes and offerings. There should have been a shout right there. See, we gotta know when to shout. Sometimes we're off on our shouts. Amen. This is a time to shout. Amen. Because when we give, as I've said before, we take on the nature of God. Amen. It is a privilege. It is a privilege. It is an honor that God has given us, so we can impact the kingdom of heaven for His glory. Amen. To get the gospel to go around the world and the word of God to go forth for the glory of God, so we can take as many as we can with us to Him. Amen. Look at somebody and say, there's work to be done. Come on now. And this is one of the vehicles that God has given us, amen, and has given us the honor and the privilege as far as giving, amen. And we should be rejoicing. We should come with expectation. We should be excited before. It shouldn't be, okay, here, don't become mechanical in your giving. I'm going to say that again. Don't become religious and mechanical in your giving, amen. It is worship. I said it is worship. Praise the Lord. If you need an offering envelope, please raise your hand. There should be one in the seat pocket in front of you. If not, if you raise your hand, one of the ushers will quickly get one to you. And watch it at home. God bless you and thank you for your faithfulness and your trust and your support to make this vision, this assignment, this miracle a reality for the glory of God. Amen. And we are impacting a world for the glory of God. Yes, we are. Look at them and say, yes, we are. And we're just getting started. I said, we're just getting started. We're just getting started. Amen. This assignment's still in the baby stages, amen? I said we're still in the baby stages of this thing. We're just getting started. I said we're just getting started. Amen? Praise the Lord. And again, and for everyone watching on phones and computers and whatever other devices that are bringing this service live to you, thank you for trusting us once again with the Word of God and the things of God. It is great to have you be part of the service. Amen. Praise God. Isaac, would you come and bless the offering at this time, please?
Heavenly Father, we come before you thanking you for this opportunity that you have given us to be into your house, Lord. Oh, we thank you for this opportunity that your Holy Spirit is already hovering over us and the Holy Spirit is guiding us and leading us, Lord. And we thank you for the things that you intend to do in our lives in the days to come, Lord. And now we bring our sacrifices of our finances, Lord. Whatever you have given us, Lord, we want to give a part of it back to you, Lord. Amen. To bless you and to honor you and to glorify you and to say that it all belongs to you, Lord. Oh, Lord, and it's all for your kingdom glory, Lord. Yes, whatever we pour into it, Lord, use it for your kingdom glory, Lord, that many souls may be added, not only in this city, Lord, not only in this nation, but throughout the world, Lord. While your word is being preached throughout the world, Lord, let your people may be awakened to the opportunity that you have given us, that you have the privilege that you have given us, Lord, that take your word and run to and fro, that many souls may be brought, Lord. Bless each and everyone who is pouring into it, Lord, and bless who are unable to pour right now, Lord, that in the days to come they may be able to be a blessing, Lord. And right now, Lord, through this drama and through the word, Lord, encourage us, Lord, so that in the days to come we may be a mighty voice for you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You guys go ahead and serve the people at this time. And Isaac, why don't you give us a little praise board? Maybe I didn't get a chance to get the pictures up, but from the last time, you want to just share some of the giving, you know, you guys, the India missions that you see the box that we've been given to. Here's a little praise report, and you guys are going to be going back here in a, next month. So, you know, why don't you share a little bit again, because this is one of our missions that we're reaching out and ministering to young kids, children really, that are by them, no parents, or you know, and it's in this and they're and we're supporting. This is part of the support to feed, to help, to supply. I think this last time that we sent money to them was for like some school supplies, correct? So why don't you share that real quick so people know where.
Praise the Lord. And I just want to thank everybody over here who has been supporting the ministry in India. That last month we had sent some money from here, and it was more than enough for them to buy their school supplies. So all the kids in that orphanage, there are about 40 to 50 kids in between, they were able to take their school supplies and go to their schools and have their education, that they may be used in a constructive way in the days to come when they grow up. And everybody has been blessed with it. I mean, a lot of few people do not know about it, but I just wanted to share it, that you are all a part of it, Lord. And God has been a blessing through you over there to the children you would never maybe able to see. You may see them in the heaven when you would be there, but not over here.
Amen. Praise you. Now, they actually sent some pictures. The directors there sent some pictures of some of the school supplies and the kids. And actually, we got them on the computer. And what we'll do is we'll put them on for like the following service, so you guys can see some of the pictures and the children and the provision as a byproduct of your giving. And also on the way in the bookstore, if you see on the wall, there's a little box for India. That's where that's all going. And the pictures, if you look at some of those pictures, those are some of the pictures. Those are some of the kids that are there. And if you notice, like, how, you know, the rooms that they're in, and it's like, you know, where they sleep, you know, they have, they're on the floors. And I mean, it's just, you know, there's, I don't know how many children like in one room are, you know, so, you know, very limited, you know, as far as space and so forth and so on. So, so they need help, amen. And we've been put in a position to be able to do it. And so let's continue to do our best, praise the Lord. And where much has been given, much is required. God has blessed this house. I said, God has blessed this house. So let's not settle. Let's not get comfortable. Let's impact the world. Amen. I said, let's impact the world in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you.
sing, but don't have love. I waste my breath with every song I bring. An empty voice, a hollow noise. If I speak with a silver tongue, convince a crowd, but don't have love, I leave a bitter taste with every word I say. So let my love be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made of. How you lived, how you died, love is sacrifice. So let my love be the proof of your love.
Angelic ecstasy, but don't love, I'm nothing but the creaking of a rusty gate. If I speak God's word with power, revealing all of his mysteries and making everything as plain as day, and if I have faith to say to a mountain, jump, and it jumps, but I don't love, I'm nothing. If I give all I own to the poor, or even go to the stake to be burned as a martyr, but I don't love, I've gotten nowhere. So, no matter what I say, no matter what I believe, no matter what I do, I'm bankrupt without love.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. I said, praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. If you have your Bibles, St. Matthew chapter 5. St. Matthew chapter 5. St. Matthew chapter 5. We're going to be starting in verse 1. Amen. And if I can have somebody in the back here turn on the lights up here on the stage too, please. St. Matthew, chapter 5, starting in verse 1. We're going to finish in verse 12. Are you ready?
Yes.
Amen. And seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. More than happy are those. Look at somebody, say, you're those. Woo! Blessed are those who are, watch me now, hear the words of Jesus here, who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed or more than happy are you, when, watch this now, when they revile and persecute you, in other words, come against you, shout, that's an enemy. Look at somebody, say, thank God for your enemies. And say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. All kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. In other words, he's saying here, blessed, more than happy are you when people gossip on you and people hate on you. Oh, Jesus. Now watch this. Watch Jesus now in verse 12. And he goes on. This just messes me up. And he says, rejoice and be not just glad, but exceedingly glad. Now prior to this, watch this. He goes, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. He didn't say be glad prior to this because you just got a new car. He's not saying start to shout, clap, and celebrate because you just got a promotion. Don't shout and celebrate. He's not saying shout and celebrate because you just got a brand new house. He says here, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Jesus is saying here, think about this. If you're going to shout a shout, if you're going to clap a clap, if you're going to jump for me, clap for me, and celebrate, the time to, see, we sometimes, as far as our celebrations and our shouts, we have a tendency to miss the right time to shout, amen? When we have an enemy that is introduced into our life, we as a people of God have a tendency to put our heads down. We have a tendency to cry out to God and say, Lord, take them out of my life. But Jesus here is saying, if you're going to shout, if you're going to celebrate, celebrate when people come against you. Shout when people come against you. Rejoice when people come against you. I mean, but when you really think of it, that goes contrary to the system of this world, amen? But again, we're not of this world anymore. We're of another world. We're of his kingdom, and his kingdom and this kingdom are diametrically opposed. So Jesus says here that, hey, when you've got some haters, when you've got some enemies, and they come in different forms, from within the church, in ministry, outside the church, at work, supervisors, and within the families. And I want to talk to you just for a few minutes here this morning on the topic of thank God for your enemies. Thank God for your enemies. Find three people with a big old smile and thank God for your enemies. Now why would Jesus here in our text say, blessed. You're blessed when you're persecuted. You're blessed when people say things about you. You're blessed when all kinds of evil and falsely accuse you. You're blessed, and rejoice and be exceedingly glad. I mean, why would he say that? Well, number one, watch this. Because when you've got people coming against you, that means you're doing something right. I said when you've got enemies that rise up against you, that means you're doing something right, because the devil is not going to come against you if you're sitting at home doing nothing for the kingdom of God. But when you're doing something for the glory of God, for the kingdom of God, and you are moving for the glory of God, you are not sitting around, you're not waiting for the rapture to come, amen, but you're stepping outside the four walls of the church, and you are being salt to a world that needs Jesus, amen. The enemy will come against you, and the enemy, watch this now, because he can't get you the way he used to get you back in the day with some of the stuff you were involved back then. So what does he do? He works through the weaknesses of people, amen, because remember, God uses people on this earth. He uses me. He uses you. We carry the presence of Almighty God. The Bible says you shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. In the same way, though, in weaknesses in people, the enemy will use people's weaknesses to come against us, to frustrate us from moving forward and accomplishing the greatness that God's called us to. So within families, within the church, within ministries, supervisors at work, amen? Because, watch this, when you're doing something right, the enemy is going to come against you. He's going to come against you. So don't be discouraged when that happens. You should be encouraged. That's why Jesus is saying this, because you're doing something right for my kingdom. You're doing something. Look at somebody, do something. We haven't been called to put a permanent residency on this earth. The Bible says our citizenship is not here, but it is in heaven. We've got work to do. Number one, come in a relationship with Jesus. Number two, sustain a relationship with Jesus. And number three, bring as many as we can with us to Jesus. I just gave you God's will for every single person in this room. Amen. What's God's will? 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 Save souls. With whatever platform God has given you. So he says, rejoice, be glad, be exceedingly glad, because you're doing something right. You're doing something right. Because if you're not doing something for the glory of God, that means nothing is happening. And that's a scary thing. But when you're doing something right, the enemy will come against you when you're serving the Lord. And number three, watch this now. I just want to, just before I go any further, as far as our enemies, because I mentioned that God uses us, so the enemy will use people also in their weaknesses to come against us. But we need to also, when an enemy comes against us in the form of a family member sometimes, amen, in a form of a person, a brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so within the church, amen. At work, a manager, a supervisor, we have a tendency to always say, okay, you know what, Lord, take them out, Lord, do this. No. You know what God says? Love them. So I need to establish this real quickly before we move any forward. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, 11, and 12 says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord in the power of his might, but put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Amen. The Bible says offenses will come. When somebody comes and attacks you, when you have an enemy in a form of a person at work, within the church, within the ministry, at home sometimes. Amen. You don't look at your neighbor and say, don't take it personal. Because everybody's in different places. And watch this. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 23, here is Jesus turning to Peter after Peter says to Jesus, you know, after Jesus had mentioned and told the disciples, I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to die. I'm going to be raised from the dead. And Jesus is like, no, you can't go. Peter's like, no, you can't go to Jesus. We can't. No. And then all of a sudden, Jesus turns around to Peter and says, get behind me, Satan. This is Peter. This is one of the disciples. Get behind me, Satan. His moment of weakness, the enemy was using Peter to hinder Jesus from moving forward. But we know later on that Peter went on and preached the gospel, preached his little heart out. On the day of Pentecost, 3,000 people were saved. He went on to write 1 Peter and 2 Peter, and Peter finished strong. So watch this. We need to pray for our enemies. Before we go any further, we need to pray for that enemy that's been introduced in our life. For love covers a multitude of sins. Because they might not be, watch this now. God has brought that person in your life also, and you might be the only Bible that they might see. And the seeds you're planting, at that moment could be the difference of heaven or hell later. So we need to pray for them. But what we have a tendency to do is, Lord, take them out. And if they never change, then God will handle your enemies. But God willing, our prayers, because there's people in my life that came against me when I first got saved that were close to me but did not understand some of the things. And now, you know, have you ever gotten this? Well, it's like, oh, so now you think you're better than us. And, you know, all just to discourage you. But see, in their weakness, the enemy was using them to discourage me at that point from going to church and doing the right thing. Feeling, no, I'm not better, amen. I'm just thankful that God saved me, delivered me, but I just can't go back. But see, the enemy was using their weaknesses to pull me back in and say, you know what, to pull me back into that, some of that old stuff. And it's like, no, I'm not better, but I'm not going back over there. If you want to run with me, if you want to roll with me, you've got to come where I'm at, amen. But at that point, it was the weakness, and the enemy was using to try to come against me at that point. But that stirred me up even more, as the Word of God says also, because that meant I must be doing something right, because now, praise the Lord, I mean, all hell's broken loose, and it's coming from all directions. I go to work, it's coming against me. I'm at home, it's coming against me. Wherever I'm at, it seems like all hell has broken loose, so that means I'm doing something right. We need to pray for our enemies. We need to pray for our enemies. And if they don't, because there's many that came against me that now are on fire for Jesus. So understand, some of your enemies could become some of your closest, laborers and for the gospel, amen, in the future. So remember that. Look, remember that. Jesus, watch this, Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 through 48. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Ah, but I, who says? Jesus. It's not the next door neighbor. I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you. Do good to those who hate you. What? Do good to those who hate you and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore you shall be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen. I say to you, love your enemies. Love, do good to those who hate you. So when an enemy's been introduced into your life, we need to establish this, that the enemy, just like in Peter for a moment there, it doesn't mean that, maybe, you know, it could be your prayers could be the difference of them finishing strong for the glory of God. So pray for them. I said pray for them and keep moving forward and keep doing the right thing. Look at somebody and say, keep doing the right thing. So Jesus says, rejoice when you're when haters and gossipers and all this starts to take place, because that means, number one, you're doing something right. We have established now that we need to love and pray for our enemies. And also, are you ready for this? I don't know if you're ready for this. It is also, write this down, it is an announcement. It is a prophecy. I said it is prophetic. When an enemy or enemies have been introduced into your life, it is prophetic that one season in your life is coming to a conclusion. When an enemy starts to come against you and all hell's broken loose against you and is coming against you, it is prophetic. It is an announcement that a season in your life is now coming to an end, and God is about to open a new door, a new season of greater anointing, greater favor, greater influence, greater power, greater, shout hallelujah. It is prophetic. That's why Jesus was saying, when you are being attacked and people are coming against you, you need to start to be exceedingly glad. You need to clap your clap like never before. You need to lift up your head, because promotion is about to take place. I said promotion is about to take place. Your friends encourage you. Your family humbles you. But your enemies promote you. I said your enemies promote you. No, you can't handle me this morning. Are you ready for me? It is prophetic. Pray for them. Release them in God's hands. Embrace your enemy. Because it's your enemy that is preparing you for your new season. It is your enemy or enemies that are preparing you for increase. And many in this room, have had some enemies come against you strong. And if you're doing your best to do it God's way, here's your prophecy that lets you know that the season you've been in, I said the season you have been in is coming to a, and it prophesies. That's why he says, be exceedingly glad. That's why he says, start to rejoice when people start to speak all sorts of stuff about you and all hell's been broken against you. Because, watch this, a season's about to conclude in your life, and I'm about to open a brand new door. A new season's about to come into your life, and it's a season of greater increase, greater power, greater anointing, greater favor, greater influence. For my glory, amen. One season's closing and a new, you're about to step into a greater season. You're about to be promoted. Look at your neighbor and say, thank God for your enemies. Thank God for your enemies. Woo! We're trying to pray away. We're trying to push away the thing that's helping you go to the next level. Before David became king, he was being chased around by King Saul. Shout, that was an enemy. King Saul was trying, because somebody would say, well, give me some scripture, give me some Bible. I'm giving it to you right now. What do you mean? My enemy, one season's closing, a greater season's about to open up. I'm giving you some Bible, amen? King Saul was trying to take out David because of his jealousy, his envy, because of all the attention that David was receiving. So he's trying to take him out. In reality, he should have been rejoicing with David and thanking God for David, because David was a blessing to his ministry. So I just never have understood. I need to stop and just say this. I have never understood people that get jealous and envious of others. Amen. Because watch this. If I'm connected to you, praise the Lord. When someone gets blessed, when someone has increase in their life, amen. When God's doing something in somebody's life, why would you get jealous? Amen. If you're connected to that person, if you have fellowship with that person, I'm not going to push you away. I'm going to get a little closer to you, because some of that blessing will get on me. Amen. I'm not going to hate. I'm not going to hate. Why would I hate? Why would I hate? That's ridiculous. I'm just going to get a little closer to you so I can get some of the overflow. Turn around. There he is. You better believe it. Praise the Lord. King Saul was trying to kill David. But watch this now. David had an opportunity to take him out, but he didn't touch him. Even at that point, David said, that's God's anointed. He understood, even in his weakness, even when Saul was off, that's not my place. That is not my place. I'm going to keep doing my part. I'm going to keep doing the right thing. And the rest is in God's hands. And if he doesn't change, God will take care of him. God will confront him when it's time. Some of your enemies, you don't have to get the last say. Keep doing the right thing. Keep moving forward. Keep serving the Lord. Amen? And let God take care of it. And God willing, they'll change. They'll change. But the point I'm trying to make is Saul was introduced into his life. And watch this. What was happening? A season in David's life was coming to a conclusion. And watch this, and the increase and the anxiousness, when the enemy gets really anxious and it seems like, man, the fire's been turned up and it's more intense than ever before, that's what was happening. But watch this, that meant that, watch, that season was coming to a conclusion, that David was about to step into a new season, a new season. He was about to go from a shepherd boy to... from a shepherd boy to what? But there was an enemy between a shepherd boy and a... Before Joseph became prime minister, towards the tail end of it, his 13 years, Potiphar's wife makes a run at him. Joseph stays pure in the sight of God and runs from that temptation, the Bible tells us, and honors God. But in the midst of it, he was still wrongfully accused and ends up in a dungeon, in a cell, in a prison towards the tail end, after being sold into slavery from his brothers, amen? So at the tail end, but watch this now, Potiphar's wife, can you shout, that's an enemy? That's why Jesus was able to say here in chapter 5, rejoice. Because when you read it, it just, what do you mean, Jesus? Blessed? Why am I, when they persecute me, blessed? I'm blessed when people revile and persecute me and say all kinds of evil against me and falsely for my, wait, and kinds of evil against you and falsely for my sake, and so they come against me and they lie on me and they hate on me, and you're saying rejoice. Yeah, because see, watch this, because Jesus is saying, listen, don't you understand, when that all starts to happen, you're doing something right. That's why you just need to pray for them, because you're about to go to the next level. That's why you need to start shouting. That's why you need to start clapping like never before. That's why you need to lift up your head. Stop putting your head down, because you're about to go from a shepherd boy to a king. You're about to go from the prison to the palace, Joseph. You're about to go from one place to the other. The season that you're in today, your enemy prophesies that that door is about to shut and you're about to step to another level. Higher, further, stronger, more increase, more favor, more power, more influence for the glory of God. Shout yes. When it got more intense for Joseph, the closer he became to becoming prime minister. See, when the enemy gets anxious like that and comes against you, he's threatened by what you carry, the dream that God's put in your life, the assignment that God's put in your life, the purpose that you've been called to on this earth for the glory of God. And he's threatened, and he's afraid. So the closer you get to the next level, to the next place in your life that God's going to bring you up to, he knows the higher you go, and the next level is going to impact more people. More people are going to be impacted. More lives are going to be touched for the glory of God. Because the higher you go, the greater the influence, the greater the power, the greater the anointing. People are going to be set free. More will be set free. More will be delivered. More will be saved by your promotion. So then he gets really anxious and he comes against you even greater, with greater force. But my God, when that starts to happen, guess what? You're about to go into a new season of greater influence and greater power and greater blessing and greater reward. It is a prophecy that something great's about to happen. Your enemies are an indication that promotion is coming your way. Shout, I believe Acts chapter 8. We've been here before in this text. Bible says a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem. What? Great what? The persecution came through what? The TV? The radio? It came through people. You see what I'm saying? Came through great persecution to bring fear and to paralyze him from moving forward. That's why Jesus so says, rejoice when persecution hits, because promotion's about to happen. Philip ends up in Samaria because of the persecution. Philip, because the church was scattered, the Bible says. So their enemies were the best thing that ever happened to the church. Your enemy that's in your life right now, you need to thank God for them right now. You need to shout right now. You need to celebrate right now for that enemy. You know what you need to do? You need to get some information on them also, just in case there's some that you'll never see again and maybe some that will never, you know, get it right. Amen. But watch this now, and just get their information, get their email, get their phone number or something. So by the end of the year, when the new year comes, you can call, leave a message, or send them an email and say, thank you for gossiping on me. Thank you for hating on me. Thank you for coming against me. Thank you for trying to keep me down. Thank you for all the bad things you did against me. Because of you, I have received promotion, and I thank you. Send them a thank you letter with a big smile saying, God loves you and thank you. Thank you. Practice 1, 2, 3. The persecution pushed and propelled the church to places they would have never went to. Philip goes down to Samaria, preaches his little heart out. The Bible says People were set free. People were healed. The city was shaken for the glory of God. And there was great joy in that city. Would there be great joy in that city if it wasn't for the enemy that was introduced against the church in Jerusalem? Your friends encourage you. Your family humbles you. Your enemies. And the size of your enemy, also the intensity, the size of your enemy, the time, the season, the longevity of that attack, the size of your enemy also determines the size of your reward. I'm going to come back to that in a few seconds. The size of your enemy determines the size of your reward on the other side. The greater the enemy, the greater the enemy, somebody needs to shout. I'd start getting those cards and start saying thank you, 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 thank you. Tonight when you go to bed, stop staying up and letting your mind, you know, and run and run and run and oh my goodness, and just go to sleep like a little baby. Understand, promotion's on its way. Amen. Start working on your thank you cards. I said start working on your thank you cards. Start working on your thank you cards. Start working on your thank you cards. Hallelujah. Also, when an enemy's been introduced, pray for your enemies. Love them. Keep doing the right thing. Let God handle the rest. Number two, one season's come to an end. It's prophetic. It's prophecy for you to know that a season's coming to an end and you're about to go to the next level. And let me mess you up. If some of you can handle this and you've got the faith to receive it, if you got the faith to receive it, because I'm under an anointing here, amen? If you got the faith to receive it, before Jesus went to the cross, there was an enemy by the name of Judas. There was an enemy by the name of Judas. That prior to the cross, amen. See, but Judas was the enemy that was used at that point to get a hold of Jesus. And here's Jesus now. He came to this earth, amen, with an assignment, amen. What was happening at that point? His assignment was coming to a conclusion. His assignment was the cross, to shed his blood for you and me, to die for you and me, to be the ultimate sacrifice for you and me. When we were yet sinners, he died on the cross. So Judas, an enemy introduced, there he is within his ministry. Within his ministry. That's why we have to be careful. Amen. You know, we try to pray away. We try to push away. Let God handle that. Let God handle. Amen. We just have to let God handle some of those, because some of those enemies, oh, and they're in here. I thank God for some of the enemies in this church. And God willing, the prayer is this. Lord, touch them, change them. But Lord, if not, in your time, in your season, you'll take care of them later on. But what you're doing, you're helping me just get on my knees a little bit more. Woo! You're just helping me get a little closer to Jesus, to trust him a little bit more, to pray a little bit more, to fast a little bit more, to shout a little bit more, to call upon his name a little bit more. So to all the enemies that have come under assignment in this place, thank you. Thank you. To my haters, thank you. To my gossipers that smile in my face and get on the phone the next day and talk about me. Thank you. Woo. It's getting hot in here. Judas, within his ministry, but Judas helped him fulfill his assignment. What happened when that enemy was introduced? He goes to the cross. But watch this now, the intensity of it now. The enemy working overtime to take out Jesus. One season was coming to an end. He was fulfilling a part of a season of the assignment. But watch this. Didn't we say when you one season closes, then God brings us to a higher place? Can you say 3 days later? 3 days later, one door comes to one season is concluded. The cross, it is finished. But a new door, a new season opened up. 3 days later, Jesus rose from the grave. And now, hallelujah, watch this now. Through the Spirit of the living God, more people can be touched. Everyone can. So when the enemy gets anxious and nervous and comes against you with more intensity, understand that your promotion and the increase and the new season is coming your way sooner than later. I said sooner. Lift up your hands and read. Sooner than later. Sooner than later. 3 days later, promotion. 3 days later, resurrection power. 3 days later, Jesus rose from the grave. Sooner than later! It's prophetic. That's why Jesus was able to say, rejoice. Rejoice when an enemy is introduced in your life. And here's another one. Thank God for your enemies. You know why? Because your enemies also reveal your weaknesses. Your enemies reveal your weaknesses. When an enemy comes into your life, supervisor, boss, brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so, just gossiped, just said some stuff about you, some haters, some stuff, amen. Here it is. It reveals your weakness, your weaknesses. Watch this. What comes out? What comes out of your mouth when you're being attacked? Do the words, Lord, bless them, Lord, help them, Lord, touch them, or does something else come out of your mouth? It reveals your weaknesses. Are you with me? Amen. It is in these places, amen, that God reveals your heart. Amen. Because God's trying to show you some stuff as a byproduct of that enemy that's in your life. Your enemy's actually a mirror, so you can look in the mirror to see some stuff in your life that while things are going well, everything's moving along great, blessing over here, moving forward, busy over here, doing this over here. We have a tendency to not pray as much. We have a tendency not to really examine our heart as much, amen. But when an enemy's introduced in our lives, we have a tendency to get on our knees and start crying out to God. And it's in those places when we get isolated and back to the Lord, because the intensity of the enemy now has brought us to our knees, then God says, don't worry about your enemy. What I've been trying to do is try to get a hold of you and show you your heart. I'm trying to get some of that pride out. I'm trying to get some of that lust out. I'm trying to get some of that jealousy out. I'm trying to get some of that stuff out, amen. I'm trying to get some of that rebellion out. I'm trying to get some of that gossip out. I'm trying, because if you're going to go the distance, you're going to be the champion that I called you to be. Some of this stuff's got to go. So in other words, when an enemy's into your life, introduced into your life, and the intensity of your enemy, what it does is it reveals your weaknesses. And as a byproduct of revealing your weaknesses, your enemy shows you your heart, amen? So then God can show you your heart and what's deep inside of your heart. And then, watch this, and then by confessing it and being honest and transparent and bringing it to light, then God can get some of that hell out of your heart. I said, then God can get some of that hell. I said, some of that hell that's still in there. Are you with me? Can you handle me for about 10 more minutes? Shall bring it on. And yes, I'm feeling a lot better. Genesis real quick. Genesis chapter 32, verse 23. Starting verse 23. Here we have the story of Jacob. Jacob has his brother now, he found out that his brother is coming to meet him. His brother that he tricked out of the blessing. His brother that so many years prior wanted to take him out was because of what Jacob did to him. And now he finds out years later that his brother's about to meet him. So Jacob's a little concerned. Jacob's a little concerned that his brother's about to blow him up. And the Bible says in verse 23, he took them, sent them over the brook, and sent them over what he had. So that was his family. And he's like, okay, you guys go here. I'm going to get alone with God. Something's got to give here. Then Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip. And the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaks. Now watch this. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Verse 27. Oh, this is good. So he said to him, what is your name? Now watch this. Before all this, Jacob is doing his thing, living his life. Now he's by himself. There's an enemy, or what seems to be an enemy, because we know later on that his brother, everything worked out. But at that time, that was an enemy coming his way. And his enemy revealed his weaknesses and actually got him alone to cry out and to wrestle with the Lord. Come on now. See, your enemies reveal your weaknesses. And the question was, what is your name? And watch this. And he comes to a place in his life after years of being a trickster. What did he say? What did he say in response to the question? Then the response to the question was, what is your name? He said, I am a trickster. I am a hustler. I am a player. I am a deceiver. Where's that at? Right there. He said, Jacob. I am Jacob. I am full of pride. I am full of jealousy. I am full of gossip. I am full of fill in the blank. What is your name? I have a drinking problem. I have a drug problem. It's in places like this, your enemies get you to a place where you look in the mirror and you get honest and say, you know what? I am a mess. There is some stuff still in my heart. And then watch this now. Then Jacob, because he was responded and came out and was transparent, he said, Jacob. What he said was, I'm a I've been hustling, I've been tricking for years, and I am tired of it. All this led him to this point as a byproduct of a type of enemy that was in his mind coming against him. And because Jacob brought it to the light, repented, let me say it like this. This is where God, when God reveals this and we see it and we bring it to the light, now we can, that's where the victory is, and we repent of it. Watch this now. He says, I'm Jacob. And what did he say? And he said, your name shall no longer, after he was honest, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, shout prince. That's what that means. For you have struggled with God and with man and have prevailed. Because now that you've brought it to the light, there's a breakthrough. And that weakness that was a hindrance is no longer there. You're no longer a trickster, but you are a... Our enemies help us go from tricksters Amen. Because you've heard me say that your gift, your talent will only take you so far. See, Jacob couldn't go any further at this point. Because this is character stuff here. This isn't put some hands on me and put some oil on me. This is where you look in your eye and you be honest with yourself and say, you know what? Okay, I need to work on this. But we're so busy. Watch this. When our enemies come against us, pointing the finger, God, take them out. Look at what they're doing. Look at what they're doing. Lord. And we have in our mind dreams of putting ants in their bed that bite. Come on, some of your supervisors. You know those red ants or whatever that bite, and you know. We have images in our mind for the people that come against us slashing some tires. Oh, there's at least a couple in here on that, amen. And we're so busy saying, oh, because we're so holier than thou, and we got it all together, and we're always in the right. Look at what they're doing. They're falsely accusing me. They're trying to keep me down. And God says, forget them. I'll take care of them. I'm trying to show you. When you said ants and you saw that switchblade in that tire, that's in your heart. I'm trying to get that out so you can finish strong and be a prince for the glory of God. Shout, that's me. It reveals our weaknesses. Jesus. And as I said earlier today too, your the size of your enemy also determines the size of your reward. And let me just, I got to come back on Tuesday again. I got so much. You know what's interesting is, you know, even at work at America West, when I used to work at the airlines, I remember many times where, you know, and I've shared this a couple times too, multiple times. It was another one I had forgotten about, where because the supervisors were trying to cover for themselves, they threw the blame on. The one time I told them specifically, we're going to miss all these bags. I need to handle that flight. No, you do that. I go, if I do this, then you're going to miss this flight. And all these bags are going to be misconnected. Maybe you were on that flight that lost your bag and didn't show up. That wasn't my fault. That was the supervisor's fault. That wasn't me. It wasn't me. And then I'm in the office, in the manager's office with the supervisor there, and I'm getting the blame. Can you shout, that's an enemy? But see, God was preparing me to submit, to turn the other cheek, and Lord, and God was showing me, pray for them. They don't know me. Your job right now is to pray for them. Your job is not to get the last word here. Your job is to take the hit and pray for them and move on. I'm like, what? So I sat there and didn't open up my mouth and did not try to back it up. And another time, there was another situation where I actually was written up again for a situation on a flight. And here I am after all these years working there, never been written up for anything. And again, a supervisor trying to protect himself throws the blame on me and I'm being written up. But see, what God was doing is, you know what he was saying to me right there? I'm preparing you. You're about to go from throwing bags. Oh, you're about to go from throwing bags to preaching the gospel to the nations. You're about to go from throwing suitcases in the middle of summer, and you're about to be promoted as one of my ambassadors to the nations. Shout yes. Yeah.
But in the midst of it also, there was some stuff. There was moments that God was showing my heart in the middle of summer out there when situations would come up multiple times where I wanted to say things and do things and knock people out. Just me. I know I'm the only one. One time, a situation occurred. I remember this clearly. True story. A situation came up, and I was so frustrated. I went up to this one. This guy was like a big one. And I'm like, man, you know what? You need to do the right thing. You know, because I got some UFC in me, amen? So I went up to him, right in the middle of the flight, outside. And I went up to him. It hit me at this place. And I'd been saved for like, I don't know, it's been about a year and a half now, or a year into this thing. And I went up to him, and I'm like, man, you know, that's not right. You're not keeping your word. I go, and he's like, man, just leave me alone. I go, no, you're not. And I'm pointing at him. I'm pushing him. And I'm like, you know what? No, you need to do the right thing. You're going to start doing it from right now. And he started pushing me back, and they kind of broke us up. People saw us up in the window. They reported it, and both of us ended up in the manager's office. I know it's hard to believe. I know. And thank God they broke us up, because I'm telling you, a couple more minutes, he would have been. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just playing. So I'm just playing. We're in the manager's office, and we're driving over there, and I was on my rig, and they said, you need to come. You know, they're waiting for you. And, you know, we both went. And I went in there, and on the way there, I'm telling you, I remember this. As God is my, I'm telling you, the Lord spoke to me in my spirit, not with an audible voice. He showed me my heart. And he goes, if you want to go further in the assignment I've called you in, you need to repent. You need to ask for forgiveness to the person that you came against. And basically take the whole hit for the whole thing. Because what rolls up in you, I'm trying to get out of you. Because you can't go any further with that. I went in there, and before they all said anything, I walked in there, and before anybody said anything, I go, it is my fault. And I know that I'm not going to mention the guy's name. I go, please forgive me. I was wrong. Please forgive me. And I looked at the manager. I go, it was my, I instigated the whole thing. I was in the wrong. I messed up. And whatever you guys, I understand. And you know what? And anyway, that worked out. Nothing major happened as far as that goes. The other person said, hey, it's all good. Walked away. But what happened to me, see, that enemy at that moment, it revealed some of my weakness that needed to come out. In Jesus' name. Amen. I have to just pick it up on Tuesday, because I want to talk about the size of your enemy, the size of your reward. And if I open that up, we might be here for a while. Amen. This is where I left off last night. This is where I want to pick up. The size of your enemy determines the size of your reward. Amen. But that's why Jesus was able to come. And you know, and you're like, Jesus, what are you saying? Rejoice, be exceedingly glad. Yes, because guess what? It reveals some of your weaknesses, because you're not going to go the distance if you have some of that stuff. So we're a work in process, amen? We're a work in progress, amen? And, amen. How many people want to go the distance? How many people realize there's still some work to be done inside of us? Amen? And if we're going to be the champions, character is going to take us the rest of the way. And again, it gets us to a place of one-on-one with the Lord to show us our hearts. So thank God for our enemies. Thank God for our enemies also, because it also prophesies a promotion. And I decree and declare to you today, your season's coming to an end. And a new season's about to open up of greater increase, greater power. Promotion is coming your way. Pray for your enemies. Intercede for them. Release them in God's hands. And you just be busy about the Lord's work. Let God handle them. God willing that they're going to come to the cross and get their stuff right. God willing. And if not, don't worry. God will take care of them. And if they're still in your life, there's a reason. Amen. I said there's a reason. So next time you see your enemy or what you think is an enemy, just smile. And start working on your thank you cards. Shout, I'm a prince. Lift up your hands, say, I receive it. In Jesus' name. And by the grace of God, I will pick this thing up on Tuesday. This topic is loaded, and we just scratched the surface. Amen. We're going to pick it back up on Tuesday and probably come back over the weekend once again. Okay, is that all right? Praise the Lord. Are you encouraged? Let's stand to our feet for a moment. Come on now. Hallelujah. And I want you just for a moment right now, in the name of Jesus, just start to thank the Lord. Start to thank the Lord for what he's doing in your life. Start to thank the Lord, hallelujah, for what you thought was the end. What you thought was, oh my God, this thing, I can't take another step. This enemy, what is going, Lord, thank the Lord for your enemies, amen. Start to thank the Lord for the enemies that have been introduced in your life, amen. Because all they're doing is preparing you for promotion. All they're doing is preparing your heart to go further and higher for the glory of God. Amen. All they're doing is just preparing you. Amen. Remember, your friends. What do your friends do? Your family has a tendency to do what? But your enemies do what? Amen. Shout hallelujah. Amen. If you're in this place right now and you've never given your heart to Jesus, your miracle, your turnaround starts in a relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. God is not intimidated with your sins, but he died for every one of your sins. And if you're here today and watching at home, that means it's not too late. For some, you think it's too late, but if you're alive and you're breathing, it's still time to get it right. Get it right. Just get it right. The Bible says, those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. The righteous man falls 7 times, he gets back up. For some of you that have been away from the church, and here you are today, here's your word. Get back up and get back in. But you don't know what I did a couple days. I don't care what 4 hours ago. What are you going to do right now? You have an opportunity right now because God looks at your heart right now. Right now. There's time right now to call on a merciful God to receive forgiveness as far as the east is from the west. Get back up and move forward and be the champion that God's called you to be. To be the blessing that God's called you to be. To be the prince that God's called you to be. Starts with a relationship with him. There's only one way to heaven, by the way. Not 20, not 50, not 5. The Bible says there's only one mediator between heaven and earth. His name is Jesus Christ. One that died on the cross and rose from the grave on the third day. His name is Jesus. Today, if you want to make sure you're going to heaven, forgiven of your sins, but not just that, but to do something great on this earth for his glory. If that's you, say, Pastor, I want to get it right. I want to finish strong. I'm tired of being tired. I don't want to live like this anymore. I want to live for God. I want to finish strong. I want to be the woman of God that God's calling me. I want to be the man of God that God's calling me. If that's you right now, say, Pastor, pray for me. Pray for me. I want to get it right. I want to get it right. On the count of three, let me see your hands. 1, 2, 3. Yes, yes, yes. All over. Look at this. All over. All over. All over. All over. All over. In the overflow room. Anybody else? In the, I see a hand all the way. Is that you back in the back? Is that a hand? Okay, I see. I'm just looking at these hands. I see hands all the way in the back. You know what? I was going to pray for you right where you're at, but you know what? I want to call you up. I want to, you know what? Just few, no one leaving. 12 o'clock. Look at this. That's a miracle in some way. For some of you that don't believe in miracles, that's a miracle. I prepared myself, though. This message is so loaded. I have to stop in certain places because there's no end to this. This could be two or three weeks worth of stuff. Smile, so I thank God for your enemies. And don't forget to work on those cards. Every hand that went up, this is a step of faith. This is you saying, Jesus, I mean business. I'm all yours. As a step of faith, every hand that went up, I want you to step out of your seat and come up here. Quick.
Every one word comes to mind. There's only one word.
Yes, yes. Somebody, look at this.
And only one word comes to mind. There's only one word to describe. And only one word comes to mind. There's only one word to describe.
Lift up our hands, just a sign of surrender. Watch it at home. Let's pray this prayer together. Dear God, I need you. Can't do this without you. Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart and be Lord and Savior of my life. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me with your blood. Renew a right spirit within me. I'm all yours from this day forth. Jesus, help me. I believe you died for me. Jesus, I believe you rose from the grave. And Jesus, I believe that you're the Son of the living God. And I believe today that those who call upon your name shall be saved. Today I believe that I am saved. I am forgiven. I'm on my way to heaven. And my best days are ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody shout with a shout of victory. Woo! Pray for all these up here. And if anyone else needs some agreement in prayer, just make your way up to the front. We'll have people here to agree with you in prayer. Amen. If you need Bibles up here, we got Bibles in the bookstore. I want to encourage every one of you, we get baptized. If you just gave your heart to Jesus, second Saturday of next month will be our baptismal service again. Second Saturday of next month, write that down, sign up, praise the Lord. Put action to your faith, praise the Lord, amen. And I want to encourage you, get in church. When the church doors are open, be in church and get involved in Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord, somebody needs to celebrate in this place. Something great's about to happen, amen. Praise the Lord, God bless you, we'll see you next week.